Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Quantum Curators and the Fabergé Egg by Eva St. Narrated by Lucy Rayner and Alex Wyndham. 1. Neith, Beta Earth. Has she chucked the bloody thing in the lake yet? My earpiece hissed. No, hang on. Oh, you are not going to like this. Cleo started sniggering. Some of our intel may be wrong. I didn't need to be able to see Cleo to know that her eyes were rolling. Patchy intel was our stock in trade, especially the further back in time we had to go. 7th century Britain was about as patchy as it got. It was a wonder sometimes how a culture collapsed in on itself. One minute, Roman rules. The next, hello, dark ages. And not so much dark as, for fuck's sake, you used to have underfloor heating. How could you let that go? Still, there were shining pockets of artistic wonder. However, they were then generally burnt, plundered, melted down, or in this case, dumped in a lake. Chucking stuff in water seemed to be a bizarre form of preservation. But then again, nothing about the British ever made sense. So, what don't we know? I whispered. From where I was crouched, behind a large rock dripping in wet moss, I had no clear line of sight, so was relying on Cleo, who was sitting 2 miles back with her goggles on zoom. Turns out these priestesses can't throw swords worth a damn. She lobbed it a whole foot. Bugger, I'd love to have seen that. Watch it on replay later, and be bloody glad you didn't. You'd have laughed out loud. Well, that explained the group of birds that had suddenly flown up into the sky over on the far ridge above the lake. I had wondered if a second extraction team had been sent over. God knows it wouldn't be the first time a screw-up had occurred. The Great Petersburg debacle of 1894 was still taught to first years as a salutary reminder of how not to explore a gunpowder factory. The first lesson was how to establish all friendly personnel in the vicinity. The second lesson, which seemed a surprisingly obvious one, was not to use combustible weapons in a fireworks factory. You'd think the curators of the Library of Alexandria would have been more attuned to fire-provoking situations. But hey, it's not like the library caught fire or anything. Oh, wait. What are they doing now? There was a lot of undignified arm-waving and shouting. Then two of the priestesses went and dragged a boat down to the lakeside. Now they're all getting into the boat. With the sword. Shit. Shit. Don't say it. Cleo was not about to let me forget this. She had specifically mentioned the scuba gear, and I had just as specifically poo-pooed it. Bugger. I looked at my rubber boots. Well, they were a waste of time. Did you at least pack the lungs? Yes, I said. I knew what I had to do. Damn it. I was going to be a laughingstock when I got home. Well, go fetch lot DL278643. Can you not just call it Excalibur? That's sloppy. Now strip. I was not in a good mood as I peeled off my layers on the cold and wet hillside with the wind blowing the rain into my face. Everything was making me bad-tempered, including the stupid nomenclature of our system. The whole point of our organization was that we retrieved the one-offs, the last of their kind, the unique pieces. They all had sodding names. If there were more than one of them, we wouldn't bother saving them. But no. For some reason, saving Excalibur, the legendary sword of the totemic warlord Arthur, would be better identified as item DL278643. Whatever. I bit down on the portable bottled air we nicknamed Lungs and slunk down to the water's edge. My skin was already covered in goose flesh, and my knickers and bra were hardly going to keep me warm, so I stripped those off as well. Next, I emptied my utility belt, then filled it with stones and clipped it around my waist. If the people in the little boat glanced to their right, they might have spotted me. So I lay on my belly and pulled myself into the black water. Rocks and pebbles scratched my torso until the water became deep enough for me to start swimming freely. The rocks held me under the flat, inky surface as I kept my teeth clamped around my small rebreather. "Head northeast," sounded Cleo's voice in my ear, loud amongst the silence of the dark lake. I'd have replied, but obviously my mouth was full. Tapping on my wrist piece, I texted her a quick thumbs up and began to swim at speed to intercept the boat. I had an hour of air, but there was no point in risking it. Besides, I was cold. The quicker we finished this extraction, the better. I checked my little computer again. The light was even worse this far down, and I tapped on the torch function. "Oh, nice effect. You've turned the lake a glowing green. Hang on. Yep, they're rowing towards you." My buoyancy was a perfect counterbalance, about 3 feet below the surface. I hung in the water and waited for instructions. It's fair to say that waiting for instructions isn't a particular speciality of mine. In fact, it's one of the reasons I was constantly passed over for promotion. It was felt that I wouldn't bring a positive influence to the key functions of the senior management structure, which suited me just fine. But sometimes you had to rely on others, and if there was one person into whose hands I would willingly entrust my life, it was Cleo. Unlike me, she had regularly been offered promotion, although obviously not in personnel. That wasn't her skill set, which was why I was team leader. Other than that, the girl was a wunderkind. But she too loved being out in the field, so it stuck together. Most retrieval units worked in pairs, though sometimes a couple of pairs would work together if it was a complicated extraction. Occasionally, there'd be a solo worker, one who no one else could work with. They did well enough, but they could be total pains in the ass as well. They were usually long in the tooth and spent all their time telling us that back in their day, blah, blah, blah. I have no time for lone wolf bravado. "Okay, they're almost with you. Start your ascent now." Very carefully, I began kicking upwards. I knew the folklore for this event. It was essential that only my forearm broke the surface. Cold air blew across my fingers, and I opened my palm. I was tempted to beckon with my finger, but I thought that might be too silly. "Oh, wow, they are freaking out. Stay still. They're turning towards you. Get ready." The next moment, I felt a hard pommel in my hand, and I wrapped my fingers around it. The second they released it, both me and the sword plunged to the bottom of the lake. "That wasn't very graceful."
"You okay?"
No, I was not okay. My arm had nearly been wrenched from its socket, and I had to drag the wretched thing out of the soft mud that lined the bottom of the lake. This was how it was lost. Simple silt and evaporation. Within only a few years, this land would begin to dry up, old lake pits would be filled in and leveled up, and eventually, Excalibur would sit under many meters of earth and tarmac, never to be seen again. Cue me. I began walking along the lake bed, dragging the stupid noble sword behind me and swearing at every step. At only 5 foot, I wasn't much taller than the sword itself. I'd had to switch my torch off, and now I was stubbing my bare feet on every branch and rock that littered the floor. At one point, an eel slithered past my leg, and I almost spat my lungs out. Pausing to regain my wits, I continued to trudge to the water's edge. "Hold your position. They're tying up the boat and heading towards their cart. I'll let you know when they're over the brow of the hill. I'm heading your way now." I stood there, head still beneath the icy surface, shivering and cursing. This was one of my most tedious extractions ever. Where were the ropes, the guns, the fights, the chases? That was the sort of extraction I enjoyed. Grabbing the item from the flame, outrunning a volcano, snatching it from gangsters. It was not shivering in a dark bog of a lake, waiting for some wafty priestesses, with a proclivity for dumping precious artefacts into lakes, to slowly trundle away. Out you come. A few more steps, and I emerged from the water, removing the breathers from my mouth. Next time, let's factor in the weight of the retrieval item, shall we? Cleo laughed at me.
Holy cow, Neith. Wait till you see yourself on the replay. You look like the creature from the Black Lagoon.
She untangled me from the pondweed that I'd accumulated and took the sword from me. No slacker at the bench press, she also grunted in surprise at the sheer weight of it.
Crap. Yep, see your point. Get dressed, and we'll step back. No point in stepping back naked.
Nudity wasn't an issue in our culture, but I didn't need to give the guys a free laugh. Not very showy, is it? I was expecting more bling. We both looked at the sword. It was a beast of a weapon. I suppose anything capable of hacking through a body didn't also need to sparkle. I pulled on my trousers and was grateful for the wicking lining that absorbed the water. Being clammy would have been the final insult. With my jacket zipped up, we prepared to leave. Protocols. Wrap the blade in the blanket. Keep the tip on the floor and your hand on the pommel. On the count of five, step through after me. I agreed and prepared the sword. Step through protocols were essential. The quantum functions of the field were normally the same for both parties. But sometimes things went wrong. People were known to come through hours apart, and sometimes they arrived on top of each other. Early efforts had shown that being attached to another human didn't always work. The first person that stepped back discovered they were holding a hand. The second person stepped back screaming their head off, with arterial blood pumping out on the floor. One time an archivist had come through at a run, with their dagger still pointing forward. They impaled the section chief, who had died instantly. Hence all the protocols. Often the most dangerous parts of the extraction were not the volcanoes, earthquakes, or the gangsters, but the simple laws of quantum mechanics. Anything could happen, and usually did. Ready? I nodded. We both tapped in the recall code, and then she was gone. 5 seconds later, so was I.
2. Julius, Beta Earth. Julius Strathclyde glanced up from his desk as someone loudly proclaimed their arrival at the far end of the Fitzwilliam Museum's acquisitions department. Julius could only think of one person so lacking in the social conventions of the workplace, Charles Bradshaw. If Julius hadn't gone to school with him, they'd probably never have been friends, they were so chalk and cheese. He smiled inwardly, thanking fate. Charlie might be colossally annoying at times, but he was still his best friend. It was just that, as always, his timing was appalling. He sighed as he checked his watch. There were 3 more box files to catalogue, and he was looking forward to a particularly knotty issue of Provenance in the second box. There was no way Charlie was just going to sit quietly and wait whilst he did that. Hopefully he was simply popping by to say hello. Julie, my boy! Charlie slapped his hands on the desk, causing other researchers to glare in annoyance. Come on, I'm here to spring you from your dungeon. Julius rolled his eyes. Charlie was a bright guy, so why couldn't he remember how much he detested that nickname? However, Julius was due to go for drinks with Rebecca later on. If he got stuck into the catalogues now, he might lose track of time, and Rebecca didn't approve of tardiness. Losing track of time showed a lack of foresight. If you knew something was going to be interesting, she believed, then you should allot more time to it. Julius's problem was that he never knew what was going to be interesting until he opened the box. If he went for a drink with Charlie now, he wouldn't get lost in his research and let Rebecca down. After telling Charlie to pipe down, he filled in the chits saying the boxes remained uncatalogued, then sent them back to the stacks. Julius had come to Cambridge to get his degree and stayed for his fellowship and doctorate. primarily, he was a research professor at Emmanuel College. His field of study was theology and philosophy of religions, with a specialism in folklore. It paid well enough for his needs, but he supplemented his wage by working part-time in the Fitzwilliam as an archivist in the acquisitions department. The money was okay, but he would have been just as happy to do the work for free. There was no better way to spend his time than sat at a desk tracking down a footnote or establishing a provenance. He secretly thought of himself as an Indiana Jones of the library stacks. He laughed, thinking about his school friend, who was more an Indiana Jones figure in real life. Charlie was a freelancer working for a variety of prestigious museums. He would go out into the field, purchasing various items or traveling with certain collections. His portfolio was loose enough that he never got bored. There was one principal difference between the two men. Charlie went out and acquired the stuff from the darkest corners of the globe, while Julius waited until someone placed it in front of him. As the two men stepped out onto the street, they were almost immediately accosted by a pod of cyclists. In the narrow medieval streets of Cambridge, a bicycle was easily the quickest way to get around, and indeed most of the buses and lorries had been banned from the centre of town. Walking along the street, they attracted the usual second glances from giggling students and tourists alike. Normally, Charlie would preen, knowing the world was his oyster. A tall, blonde, former rower, he regularly turned heads with his good looks and cheerful smile. Standing next to Julius, though, he couldn't guarantee the looks were meant for him. There was no getting away from the fact that Julius was a particularly handsome man. When he had first started school, his blue eyes had peeked out from below a dark, floppy fringe. Yet the soft, winsome features of a boy had sharpened as he became a teenager, and his bone structure solidified into something you could chisel. In Charlie's eyes, Julius's only redeeming features were that he was rubbish at sports and had absolutely no comprehension of his good looks. Julius believed what he looked like was completely irrelevant. If anything, at times it could be a misleading hindrance. He'd noticed early on in his studies that people didn't take him quite as seriously as some of the other scholars. He remembered hearing a female model once complaining that no one listened to her because of her looks. He had promptly brought her a drink, and the two of them had got into a lengthy debate on string theory. His friends had hoped that may have been the start of something beautiful, but there had been no chemistry, just academic attraction. Indeed, they still kept in touch, but only to discuss the latest theories or discoveries. Julius had begun to walk towards the King's Arms, a rowdy sports pub that Charlie favoured, when Charlie suggested the Old Fox instead. They made their way to a quiet corner of the pub, then Julius ordered 2 pints of beer and some pork scratchings before the pair of them settled down into the booth. "So, Julie, how's it hanging? It's been months since I saw you." Julius mumbled noncommittedly. No matter how interested Charlie was, he had something he wanted to tell Julius about. Julius loved to hear his friend's adventures come to life. As he had chosen the Old Fox, Charlie obviously had a good tale to tell, so Julius settled down to be entertained. Sure enough, once Julius mentioned his plans for the weekend with Rebecca, Charlie nodded, then with great enthusiasm promptly started to talk about himself. "The new exhibition? It's fascinating. I helped curate that when it opened in Rome. Well worth a visit. Check out the priest's headpiece. Some idiot had actually labelled it as a sword hilt, if you can believe that. I said to Claude, 'Claude, I can't possibly put my name to this exhibition if you're going to let that error be made public.' He was incredibly grateful. God, imagine the embarrassment." Charlie continued to reveal ways in which he had saved the day, and Julius's mind began to wander. Sipping on his beer, he wondered if he could cross-check the provenance with the auction catalogues held in the Courtauld Institute. "But that wasn't the most interesting thing about it." Julius quickly replayed the last few minutes. A grateful cardinal, a canoe trip in Borneo, malarial antidote, 2 sisters and some absinthe, a wooden codex, a child's toy. A child's toy? That was the last thing he'd mentioned. What had been interesting about that? "You don't say," Julius said, playing for time. "Inside was a note saying the first doll has the egg." Julius was struggling to keep up. He couldn't remember what the toy was. "No, I'm sorry, you've lost me." He tried to piece together everything that Charlie had been saying in the past few minutes. There was a Russian doll's house, maybe. Something about a doll having an egg and a note in Russian. Julius was lost. Charlie banged his pint on the table. "What do you think, eh?" Having made the announcement, he headed back to the bar for another round of drinks, whilst Julius thought over what he had said. A note about an egg hidden in a Russian doll might mean anything, but it was impossible not to rush to the obvious conclusion, a Fabergé egg. Well, what do you say to that? Charlie returned to the table and placed a second pint in front of Julius. Tell me again about the toy. I was in Poland visiting the new exhibition on lost childhoods, and I got chatting to this little babushka. She said she'd offered to sell an old matryoshka set to the museum, but they weren't interested. Well, you know me. I'm always one to have a look, and I'm a sucker for Russian nesting dolls. Julius raised an eyebrow. Charlie was a well-known dealer in museum-quality artefacts, but sometimes he sailed very close to the line regarding stolen antiquities and pillaged sites. Charlie was never one to turn down a back-alley deal or an interesting lead. He had caused an absolute stink in Iraq the previous year when he was found to have a Mesopotamian vase on him that he was apparently in the process of returning to the Iraqi embassy. The problem was that he was in the airport at the time, heading home to the UK. The British Museum vouched for him, saying they were preparing to authenticate and preserve it, but there were some very uncomfortable conversations on both sides. Julius took a swig of beer and motioned for Charlie to continue. The pub was beginning to fill as the office workers arrived for a quick drink before heading home. Well, we went back to her flat, where she pulled out as fine a samovar as you'd be likely to see outside of a museum, and started to make tea. Her flat was a little cavern of treasures. Every sideboard was full of trinkets, every wall covered in paintings and mirrors and hangings. It was really quite marvellous. Anyway, she bustled off to another room and returned with a Russian doll set. I saw at once why she thought the museum might be interested. It was very old. At a glance, I felt certain it was pre-war, but it was missing the largest doll, and whilst it rattled, I couldn't initially open the first doll up. So, how do you know there was a note in there? Charlie drank deeply and smacked his lips. Patience. Anyway, she told me how much she wanted for it, and I could see why the museum had balked. I asked her if she wanted to sell anything else, and she said that this was the only thing she was interested in getting rid of. It had a sad history, and she wanted it out of her house. Sad history? Well, yes, that certainly attracted my attention, but she refused to say any more. By now we were on the vodka, and I must have been mellowing, because lo and behold, I went and paid her the full price. I wandered back to my hotel with the doll in a plastic bag, chiding myself as a fool for the little old lady routine. Anyway, I boxed it up and posted it home and flew on to Baghdad. Baghdad? They let you in? Charlie seemed peeved for a moment and then remembered there was no point in acting indignant in front of Julius. They knew each other too well. Yes. Now then, you see, that was a misunderstanding, he said, and they both laughed. Julius was properly intrigued now. So, what happened when you got home? He asked. Well, the central heating had done its standard job and had very gently dried the wood, and voila, it opened up. Inside were five more nested dolls. I opened each doll, lining up the whole set, and inside the final one, the size of a thumbnail, was a little folded note. Charlie paused. Thirsty work, this? Julius grinned and headed to the bar. He had to wait as a bunch of students debated over the various merits of ale or lager. One of the girls stepped aside to let him stand at the bar beside her. As she smiled at him, he remembered he needed some more toothpaste. Getting their drinks, he hurried back to his friend. You are rubbish with girls, aren't you? Julius looked at Charlie, puzzled. What on earth was he on about? Sometimes that was a clear failing in Charlie, always off on a tangent. The note? What did the note say? Charlie rolled his eyes. At school, the other boys had marveled at Julius's lack of self-awareness. A few subtle advances also ruled out his interest in boys as well. He just seemed utterly without desire. Unless it was an old book or a maths problem, he just didn't engage. Charlie, the note. Now you're interested, he teased, gesturing his pint towards the bar. Gorgeous girl, cracking figure, nothing. Piece of paper in an old wooden toy, all ears. Okay, he said, and raised his hands as Julius glared at him. So, the note. On it, written in Cyrillic, was the following message. The family egg is in the first doll. That's probably nothing, said Julius. There's more. I called up the old lady, Zofia, and asked if she remembered where the outer doll was. She said her brother-in-law had it. The brothers had fallen out, and their grandfather had said families should stick together. He gave Philip the outer doll and Jan the inner set. He sealed both of them and said the boys should bring them together and heal their rift. I asked if that was typical of him, but she said she had never met the old man. She did say he'd been a soldier during the Russian Revolution. Oh, Julius said, and leant back in his chair, crossing his arms. He looked up at the ceiling as he thought about it, a small, excited grin lighting up his face. It was simply impossible to not hear Egg's Russia and hidden clues without homing in like an exocet on the inevitable conclusion. A Fabergé egg. Could it be that one of the famed missing imperial eggs was about to be found, or at least that a genuine clue might have come to the surface? So many treasures of the Russian imperial court had been lost following the revolution. The jeweled Easter eggs made by Carl Fabergé for the Romanov royal family were the most sought out of them all. The two men talked excitedly, guessing who the family might refer to, if indeed it even was a Fabergé that the note was referring to. So, that's what I need from you, announced Charlie. I don't know anyone better than you at research. Can you investigate our babushka's husband's grandfather? Everything you can find. Also, I need you to find the brother. But, you know, don't mention this to anyone. Not even, what was her name? Rebecca? Julius gulped. Rebecca. Checking his watch, he realized he was late. So much for not being distracted.
3. Neith, Alpha Earth. Stepping through the queue field was disconcerting. Until you became used to it, it usually resulted in vomiting, or screaming, or fluency in French or Mandarin. Some came through convinced they had tails that had failed to materialize. Others thought they were fish. Some never recovered and became gardeners. Some died. Although deaths were rare, the pre-vetting process was thorough. I like to think of us as the best of the best. Others like to think of us as unhinged psychopaths. As I stepped onto the landing apron, Cleo was standing to my left, and we both stepped smartly away from the quantum field. A perfect transition. In the past, quantum curators would have been greeted with a round of applause, but these days that was considered showy. Personally, I liked showy. I looked up to the guys on the gantry, who flashed us a thumbs up. A couple of officers with guns stood at the other side of the room, and we smiled at them. It was always a good idea to let the people pointing guns at you know that all was well. Then the glass doors opened, and medics walked in, giving us restorative jabs and broad-spectrum antibiotics. Excalibur may not have been the only thing we carried back with us. Finally, the archivists came forward and removed the sword. We headed to the changing rooms, where Cleo had to drag me away from the gloriously hot shower before we went upstairs and away from the Q zone to give our report. The Q zone consisted of the Q field itself, which was, to all intents and purposes, a blank wall, the large empty room, or landing apron, and then the lower and upper gantry for the personnel, with changing rooms and an emergency triage station to the side. Due to the side effects of the queue field, most other departments and offices were located further away. It used to be a lot smaller, but an accidental incursion by rhinos had changed that. They'd had to pretty much rebuild the entire room after a terrified rhino had gone on the rampage. Now the queue field opened onto a large empty room, with the technicians on overhead gantries. As soon as we stepped into the corridor, I breathed a sigh of relief. I loved the warm, dry Alexandrian climate, and I couldn't wait to get outside and bathe in the warm air. Maybe even take a quick swim in the Mariotis. Proper, clean water. In the meantime, we discussed how we would approach the report. Which bit do you think we'll get bollocksed the most for? Miscalculating the weight of the sword? Or not packing proper scuba gear? Cleo thought about it. It's going to be the weight thing. The lack of full scuba gear didn't impact on the mission. And as it turned out, we were able to successfully weave into one of the established Arthurian myths. I frowned. Both of us should have spotted the weight problem, but it was just the sort of thing that I was expected to overlook, forget about, or miscalculate. Therefore, the onus of responsibility would fall unfairly on Cleo's shoulders. We headed into the chief's office, where the sword was already laid out on a preservation board. Once our report had been submitted, verified, and approved, it would be attached to the board, and then the two would be filed together in the vaults a few hundred meters beneath our feet, ready for further processing. The Library of Alexandria was one facet of our Mauseon complex, and I might be biased, but our Mauseon was the best in the world, given that it was home to all the unique and lost items from Beta Earth. There isn't a Beta comparison, as their museums are a pale shadow of the glories of a proper Mauseon. Each branch was split into 9 muses, so we had the library department, the art department, the music department, the artifact department. Well, you get it. And all are currently being filled up with specimens from Beta Earth.
Morning, ladies. Who wants to explain the cock-up, then?
Captain Samuel Nymans was responsible for the quantum curators. He was our first port of call when things went wrong, and our first line of defense when the higher-ups decided to chew us out for mistakes. He could tear into us, shout at us, and kick our asses there and back again. But beyond this room, he would defend us to the hilt. A good guy to have on your side, even when he was screaming in your face. Today he seemed to be in a forgiving mood. I took a risk.
My fault, sir. Cleo asked me to collate the item specifics. I forgot to get the weight.
Sam raised an eyebrow, whilst Cleo stood stock still beside me. Stepping in now to contradict me would suggest a lack of team unity, possibly a greater sin.
Is that correct, Cleo?
Sir?
Did Neith fail to log the weight of the sword?
Yes, sir.
That you asked her to do?
Sir?
Neith says you asked her to collate its dimensions.
Sir?
Well?
You haven't asked me a question, sir.
Did you, or did you not, ask Neith to calibrate the item's measurements?
Sir? Neith has already stated that to be the case.
What?
For me to suggest otherwise would suggest that Neith had lied.
A pause lingered between the three of us. A lie would suggest a reckless operative and an inharmonious team dynamic. The fact that the three of us knew I was notorious for not quite telling the whole truth was being happily ignored. So long as the job got done, who cared? That was my attitude. Besides, better a minor rebuke on my report than on Cleo's. Sam's face twitched, causing his moustache to quiver, and then he sighed.
Sit down and report.
Cleo gave her report as my eyes wandered around the room. Sam's office was lined with books, sporting memorabilia, and musical instruments. Any spare wall space featured works of art by his children. Doodles by them mastering the art of crayons or paint. Where there weren't works of art, there were photos of his family beaming out at him. They sure were a fine family. Sam was the very epitome of a good-looking man, tall and strong, with blue eyes and black hair. His skin was the color of wet sand, and his eyes sparkled. Even the crow's feet around his eyes seemed to highlight just how attractive they were. Blue eyes weren't uncommon here in Northern Africa, but they were definitely in the minority. The rest of us just had to work our shades of brown. His children were all equally appealing, as was his wife. Sickeningly, they were all bloody lovely people as well.
Neith, I said report.
I jumped, then confirmed that Cleo had given an accurate report, whatever she had just said. I went on to relate my side of the mission. Cleo agreed that, as much as she was able to comment on that, it was an accurate assessment of the extraction.
Right. Well done, ladies. A successful, if unusual, retrieval.
King of the understatement. Normally, we recovered priceless works of art or lost masterpieces. Leonardo's lost notebooks, Mozart's symphonies, Rembrandt's sea paintings, all safely secured in our vaults.
Every item was copied to the last detail in perfect holographic and 3D facsimile to be borrowed or studied by anyone on the planet. The original was safely cared for in the vaults, which again, anyone could visit. But why bother? We had made it as accessible as possible to the entire world. The sword of some quasi-mythical warlord was not our normal fare. Certainly it was talked about reverentially on Beta Earth, but not here on Alpha Earth. We had long since moved away from concepts of religion and warfare. The theory was that our Earth and their Earth parted at the burning of the Library of Alexandria. At least, that's what the philosophers and scientists suggest. They also postulate that if we can have one parallel universe, we can have a myriad. There could be Earths where the dinosaurs were never wiped out. There could be Earths where mankind never got going. There could be Earths where mankind had already become extinct. There could even be Earths where putting milk in your tea first was acceptable. Who knew? I tended to fall asleep during these lectures. All we knew for certain was that there was our Earth, and there was Beta Earth. Back when the Romans had burnt the library, we responded differently to Beta Earth. The lands of northern Africa and Persia had banded together, and history had pivoted. That's pretty simplistic, but it will do for now. The Roman army was attacked continually until, starved of grain and undermined by politics, it collapsed. Octavius fell and drowned in the glorious Aegean after a rowdy party, and the Roman Empire failed to emerge. From there, the conclave of Mali agreed that nation-building was going to destroy us. Instead, we began to focus on sharing knowledge. Mauseons became the leading forces. Certainly there were skirmishes between ruling deans and chancellors, but gradually we grew into a political structure based on knowledge and discovery. Without constant warfare for territorial rights, we worked on hunger and disease, and an equitable division of population and resources. It was all perfect. Although, if I were honest, and I said this to myself in perfect silence, it was incredibly dull. I wasn't alone. On Beta Earth, I'd have been a soldier or an adventurer, words filled with concern or scorn over here. Instead, my sort became groundbreakers. We would help tame the land for new colonies of people heading out onto new continents. Working alongside the indigenous residents, we would manipulate the migration routes of buffaloes or take out the odd tiger. With Leonardo's discovery of the quantum field, my sort were the foolhardy idiots who threw themselves off into adventures unknown. Lack of warfare, famine, or short life expectancies meant that scientific endeavors occurred quicker and worked better. Don't get me wrong, Beta Earth is not without random moments of scientific brilliance, but without the proper infrastructure, they tended to explode and fizzle out. We'd had supersonic flight since the early 1800s. Beta Earth had it briefly, and then it collapsed. Same with portable electricity storage. They still haven't progressed past a battery that can power a child's toy. Which is a roundabout way of me saying that we don't tend to value weapons of war, items that promised the resurrection of a nation's golden age, or, worst of all, a religious artifact. Along with nation-building, religion had been given a stern talking to. If people wanted to believe in gods, then all well and good. But if it couldn't be proved, then it wasn't to leave the front door. As a culture, no one complained about the lack of executions, tortures, persecutions, or deprivations. Dismissed, the pair of us headed out, leaving Sam to ponder on why we were recovering swords. Cleo punched me on the arm.
Wally, you could have ended up on desk duty for the entire weekend.
Yeah, well, I didn't. And besides which, now you owe me. First round's on you.
4. Julius, Beta Earth. Julius dashed out of the pub, promising Charlie he would be back in touch the next day to see what his initial investigations had unearthed. He ran along the pavement, and as he pulled on the door to the wine bar, a group of women spilled out. There was some laughter and gentle mocking, and Julius realized he knew them. These were some of Rebecca's friends, and indeed the last girl out of the door was Rebecca herself, who looked a lot less pleased to see him than her friends had. "Nice of you to turn up." She frowned as he leant forward to give her a peck on the cheek, then sniffed. "Have you been drinking?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.